Okay, so here is where our final tier list lies. I decided to switch things up a little bit because what's the use of having a category like Dungeon Daddy if I'm not going to stick some daddies in there?
Hi, this is Abraham El Jaguar, a professional game master.
In the future, I'd like to make more videos about like devised theater, because devised theater and D&D go hand in hand. It's wonderful. It's beautiful.
That's when the best naughty word, somebody we won't name online, will destroy you and your confidence fast if you're new. And we know who he's talking about. There's a guy out there who, you know, likes to critique game sessions and doesn't really know what he's talking about.
Good guts. He's gone into your channel because he's been banned on my channel. So I don't know what you want to do about that, but have fun with that shit.
My name is Paul, and I'll be your DM for a while. I've been playing RPGs for over 30 years and a professional DM, as well as a therapeutic game master.
For me, success at the table involves walking away feeling like the players were engaged and having fun.
TTRPG hobbyists appear to have a higher percentage of folks on the autism spectrum.
Now, and so it begins.
And the award for best player goes to Ginny. Really? You deserve it. You're such a great player. I love having you at my table.
Shauner is with us. I believe it's a first time visit, pointing out there's actually a player shortage. I don't know about that.
Today's topic is actually going to be talking about opening up the game even wider for people who are neurodivergent on the spectrum. How do we invite them to the table to engage and have a bunch of fun, learn and grow from that?
I've deleted my chill stream channel, Bear the Gen X GM. It's gone because it's not therapy, and I'm not here for therapy. I'm here to have fun. And I promise you, the day it stops being fun doing this is the day I delete this channel as well.
So I just wanted to take a minute and like, I'm so in love with this, you know, Dungeons and Dragons, Lego Dungeons and Dragons, Red Dragon's Tale set. And one of the things that's really been fascinating to me are these doors, right? So I've already done a few videos where I really have been thinking about doors from the perspective of their metaphor. But here, this is a door that literally leads into the dungeon, right? And one of the things that, you know, there's just so much that we're starting to consider, right? So this actually opens up, and you could see, you know, it's very dark in there, and that's, you know, and, but I love that this door opens, and these doors have different parts, right? What does it mean if the frame around the door is brown? What does it mean if the knob is blue rather than gold? If the window is black rather than gold? Fascinating.
The characters, here's the dragon itself separated out. Here is sort of the tavern and a couple of the NPCs. Or the PCs, rather, I guess. And there's, again, here's the... Looks like there may be some... Myconoids here, maybe? There's some skeletons. We see the beholder here. Here's the displacement beast. And the gelatinous cube. Like I said, I am extremely excited for this LEGO set. I will absolutely be figuring out whatever it takes to become a LEGO insider. And I'll be doing a live stream over on my Twitch channel building the LEGO set once I actually get it in hand, and maybe getting a chance to run the adventure as well. So,
one of the biggest worries for a game master running a Hexcrawl campaign is that your players will struggle to know what to do.
My reasoning is this: as long as everybody's having fun, everybody's playing and engaging and at the table and they're playing the game, who gives a shit how they perform?
What's up, nerds? Just taking a leisurely late afternoon stroll. Pondering things that we ponder when we walk. Tossing out some pearls of wisdom in regards to GM tips. Right? Not that I am any way, shape, or form categorically perfect as a DM. But I think I've picked up a thing or two over the past 40 some odd years.
What are the rules for D&D? So I asked some of my friends to join me so we could discuss a little bit. And believe it or not, D&D is probably one of the easiest things to actually get started in, because all you need is your imagination.
I have peaked. I ran almost 20,000 gaming sessions.
I have ran, you know, if I really, really added up and all the names signed to my thing over the years as a public game master, between 8,000 and 11,000 players since 1991. And I have ran a variety of games, a sort of freestyle game, and my own created from scratch, top to bottom, games. And I'm not just bragging. I worked my ass off. I worked my fucking ass off as a game master to be at the top. I put the time in. I made sacrifices, right? That's how it happened. That's how I got here. And I'm not going to throw that away. And I'm not going to have anyone in the hobby try to belittle me or say, oh, you're not at the top of the mountain, Steven. Oh, fucking rights I am. And when I compare myself to other game masters online, yeah, it's easy. It's easy to know for sure that I'm probably one of the best.
Like, cameras are so essential, in my opinion, to online play. And I can't run a game if people don't have their cameras on, man. Like, I don't know, man. Maybe you're not the most pretty person in the world, but I don't really care. I just want to run a cool game for you. And I need cameras for that.
Let's start with some of the most common safety tools, like the X card. This is a simple card that anyone can tap or raise if something in the game makes them feel uncomfortable.
While no D&D is better than bad D&D, pretty good D&D is better than no D&D.
I know I'm not going to be invited to any of these games, so I want to run my own. And I don't hold that against you guys. That's just life. I mean, it's perfectly fine to have like an all-male space. And that's why I have to create my own.
That would be the end of everything. If I showed up and I was like, oh yeah, guys, hey guys, I'm running game Thursday night. That's cool, right? They're like, yep, okay, see you there. 5 minutes into the session. Yeah, guys, I invited Harmony.
No, like, that would be so weird. Do you know how uncomfortable that would be for me? Like, to show up to a game with, like, 8 dudes and I don't want that. I have 2 other girls in my game, like, and we have a mixed sex game. You guys don't, and that's perfectly cool. You know, that's why I had to create my own, if that makes sense.
No way, absolutely not.
And I'm good with that. Don't worry. I don't want in your games. Like I said, it would be an equally uncomfortable experience for me. No.
You can see it for yourself. The majority of my content is neutral and positive.
Shonner's with us. Says they're not looking for actors. Says they look for proactive players that role play in character. That's not something that I ask people to do. Although it is kind of funny that you will get players, especially people who are relatively new to the hobby, who will sit there and be like, okay, so my character does this, blah, blah, blah. And then after a while, they're like, okay, so I'm going to go. So I say this. And I always get a kick out of seeing people kind of, strangely enough, this is probably an odd word to use, bloom as a player at your game table. I always think that's kind of cool.
Here's some other advice. You can still use the railroad, right? Like if you plotted out a railroad and that's what you feel comfortable with, the players don't know that like what's in the right room is in the left room. If they go off far to the left, it could still be what's on the right, you know? Like, so, I give that advice to new GMs all the time.
I've said it for years. The thing about 5e, but this applies to all D&D really in some ways, is if you play it in the conventional style, all it is video games, but slow. That's it. And who wants to, like, imagine playing a video game, but like, imagine you're playing this Baldur's Gate 3 or whatever. I don't know who would play that or why, but people are playing this stuff. Imagine if you had to sit there during each fight for like 20 minutes while the dice were rolled, as opposed to the 5 seconds it takes or whatever. So stupid. Why would you spend your time doing that? And not only are you bored, but then you're like looking around the table of 3 to 5 people. All right, let's be OSR like 2 people. That's how many friends they have. That's how many people you're looking at. And they have to do it too, and you have to wait through it. So video games are the right answer for people who just want to go do Dungeon Delve and get the ruby.
You are watching the Shonna Channel, host of Traveler, Python, CG, Skyrim, and Bikini videos.
Okay,
I guess I'll stay up here in the corner. Hey, this is Sean. What's going on? Oh, let's fix my microphone. Get over here, microphone. Okay. The rambling GM's going to talk about his defense for rules-heavy games.
Greetings. So, I've been watching YouTube, of course, reading Reddit and so on. There have been a couple videos and a couple articles, and you know, and this has been a topic for the past, whatever.
40 years.
20 years, at the very least, of discussing tabletop RPGs.
Probably 30 years. 35 years. I don't know, the hero system. When did the hero system come out? That's one of the contributing factors of rules for heavy crunch games.
Which is, you know, why don't we play more rules like games, or, you know, don't the mechanics just get in the way? You know, why do we need mechanics in the first place? We're just playing make believe. And, you know, a lot of those discussions, I think, stem from sort of folks that start the hobby in games that are relatively rules heavy, D&D, Pathfinder, you know, sort of legacy games, as it were, or mainstream games.
I call them first gen games, first generation RPGs. These are rules that, you know, every time it's your turn, you kind of, sort of, need to open the book and see what you can do on your turn. And when you decide what you're going to do on your turn, most players want to roll dice when it's their turn. So they're looking to see what kind of die rolls they can make. Sometimes before the player even knows what they want to do on their turn, they're looking up to see what kind of cool die rolls can they do, and then see what skill applies to that cool die roll. And then when they do find a rule, or they find something they can do for their turn, that turn points them to another rule, because there's a rule for the rule. You know, the old Traveler game from the 70s is like that. You know, your character wants to gamble at a casino. Well, it's not fun to just roll gambling skill or do a gambling save roll, you know, rolling under your gamble skill or something. No, they have a mini gamble game. You look up the rule for gambling, and there's a little rule. There's a game, a little mini game. Anyway, so every time you need to gamble or whatever in your Traveler RPG game session, you need to open the book to see how gambling works and what other roles you need to make for gambling. And then, you know, it asks, well, how much money did you put down? Well, how much money did I have to begin with? Did I have money? Do I have money to gamble? How much money do I want to gamble away? It's all out of character. It's all time wasting. Since there's no role play in first gen game sessions, like, what's the point? What is the point of going through all the rigmarole of all these rules? What are you trying to do? Is it to just have fun? Go see a movie if you just want to have fun.
And aren't getting what they expect out of the games, or the, you know, and or shift to like a more rules-like game, like a Powered by the Apocalypse or Fate, and have sort of a revelation. Oh my God, I was doing it wrong. These rules-like games make a lot of sense, and they hit on what I find important in gaming, and you're doing it wrong too. Like, so they.
Maybe he'll describe what rules light is. You know, there's GURPS. There's GURPS light. And there's GURPS ultralight. So how light are we talking about? 30-page book, 16-page book, 8-page book, 2-page book, 1-page book.
They want to wake up the masses, right? They have discovered Amway, and they want you to buy, you know, to buy this roll of toilet paper for $82 or this, you know, this, yeah. So, you know, would you like some Mary Kay cosmetics kind of thing? And, you know, I've always played fairly rules heavy games, you know, starting with, of course, you know, advanced D&D way back when, and into a hero system. And then writing.
Yeah, I did the hero thing. Yep. Then I did the GURPS thing. I was into the heavy. I was into the, oh, there's rules for everything. Everything you possibly can think of. Anything you can imagine, there's a rule for. I was all about trying to simulate the world in these games. Man, was I totally wrong.
Games for my table, and they're all rules heavy too. And, you know, my rules light game, I always joke that my rules light game nowadays, if I just want to do a rules light game, I don't care about the rules, we play hero system, which is considered.
Okay, well, technically there's heavy rules, medium rules, light rules. I prefer medium rules. You just want, you want enough rules for there to be some sort of a resolution system for your roleplay. Some games are so light, there's nothing to roleplay. Some games are so heavy, there's nothing to roleplay. Medium has rules for roleplay, for the most part.
Reasonably heavy by most folks, but it really isn't. But that's a different discussion. But if you ask me what my rules like go-to rules like game is, I go hero. I will run 5th edition hero if I need a rules light experience where the rule.
he's calling hero rules light compared to what? I can imagine what rules he's talking about that are heavy.
Rules don't matter, you know.
Is it just book count? You just need a core book to run the game? You don't need any other books? There's no advanced books that you need to run the game? That still could be crunchy. You know, your core book could be over 300 pages. That could be crunchy still.
Why do I stick with rules heavy games? And I obviously there's a preference aspect, which I'm actually going to touch on, but there is sort of a more general defense for, I think, rules-heavy games. And don't get me wrong, the vast majority of role players play a rules-heavy game. 5th edition is actually fairly rulesy in the spectrum of tabletop RPGs today. So
yeah, D&D 5th edition, how many books comprise basically the core rules? Is it 3 books still? How many pages is each of those books? I have the original AD&D first edition. It's like 3 books, and then I have 2 other books that go with it. The Arcana book and something else, I can't remember. But the they're pretty thin. AD&D First Edition is more of a toolbox for making your own D&D game.
You know, to some degree, I don't think rules heavy games need defending, but they're defended by the almighty dollar, right? The free market has spoken. Rules heavy games win.
Well, what happens is these companies are book publishing companies. They want to sell books. They want to pad the books, so they can charge more for the books. Everyone does it. Everyone. Anyone who's in the hardcover book business, they'll call themselves an RPG game company, but they're really just publishing books.
Rules like games, I mean, you know, take a second place. But it's interesting to talk about, right? Because I often do think about, you know, I often joke that I want to love a rules-light game enough to play it and make that my forever game. Never happened. Probably never will. I just can't.
It can happen, I suppose, when you decide to be a role player. If you're never going to be a role player, yeah, of course you're going to be looking at all the crunchy rules, all the fiddly bits.
Quite get there. Because I do occasionally have the same revelation that, man, if we could just get these rules out of the way, we could really get to the important things.
What's the important thing if it's not role play? What would that be? Faster combat?
But it never happens because I think rules heavy games, again, have a place, certainly have a place at my table. And why is that? So that's sort of what we're discussing. And why so rules heavy? Why can't you get, I can't. And I did, obviously this is unscripted, unprofessional. I have to figure out what to call this segment, the rambling GM.
These are the best kind of videos, the ones that don't have a script.
Maybe, because I will tend to ramble. But I did have, I went to ChatGPT and said, here, write me a script based on like these bullet points. And it did, it did decent.
Certainly.
ChatGPT is mostly the democratization of mediocrity, I do feel. But it did decent, which might tell me you shouldn't make this video because there's no point. But I'm not going to use the script. I'm just going to go off my note card here and ramble a bit. So if I do,
Well, sir, some versions of ChatGPT are like Big Brother. And Winston Smith suffered for it. The AI will tell you how to think.
I do, forgive me. Certainly this, you know, this is unprofessional. We are just...
You know, Grammarly tells you how to spell. How to write sentences. ChatGPT tells you how to think.
Bullshitting about games here. So I think... So why rules heavy? And in this case, this isn't preference, it's more of an explanation. But the first reason is simply legacy. I mean, these games were born of a desire to... I mean, you can go back to
war games. SPI did war games, then they did role-playing games. And they wrote their role-playing game rules the same way they wrote their war game rules. Because, you know, their customers were coming... War games were dying off. You know, they had their day in the sun. And companies thought, well, you know, this role-play stuff might be a new trend, or a fad or whatever. Let's make RPGs. So they did. Some people stuck to their guns and said, I'm never going role-play. I'm going to do war game forever. Those people are still around. They only buy war games. Their YouTube channels are still about just war gaming. I'm talking about the guys who, you know, honest to goodness war gaming with the maps and the chits. I'm not talking about the mini stuff. Miniatures war game, that's a whole different thing. I'm talking about just paper maps with grids, either square or hex, and you have little cardboard chits. Those are the pieces. No card decks. No crayons. You just need a flat surface is all.
To prime old days here and go, hey, yeah, they're all just make-believe cops and robbers, cowboys, and Indians kind of play. And they're just let's pretend, and thus we don't need rules. But, you know.
No, you still need rules for cops and robbers, cowboys and Indians, Germans versus Americans, you know, allies and axes. You need rules for that stuff. Otherwise, you have arguments. You always ask, okay, how do you die? What's a kill? You know, what's free space? Is it two against one? You know, that kind of thing.
The modern tabletop RPG stems back from, you know, the chainmail days, right? The guy, you know, everybody's heard of guy.
Oh, do we take prisoners? Where's the prison? Whose side has the prison? You know, that kind of thing.
And you know, Arneson and his gaming group wanting to bring more personal stakes to medieval war game simulations, right? So we've come from war game.
Okay, you go from an army to an army of one. That's what happened. First, you have that happen. You don't have a platoon or a squadron or whatever. You have one. You have a hero, your veteran chit, who survived, you know, four or five skirmishes. That's you. That's you now. That's your character. You're a hero. You get to have just this one unit, which is your character. Now, of course, when you're playing a war game and you just have one unit, you know, you against you're role-playing ogre. You're the ogre and you're against the army of battle suits. The player who's playing the ogre, they start to roleplay. The ogre has AI. It wants to get from its location to the command post. It's after the other player's command post. Roleplay begins to happen a little. It's just a board game, but roleplay happens because one player has one unit. Now, what if all the players have one unit? They start role-playing. It's no longer this impersonal armchair commander situation where you're overlooking, you know, 100 units, and each unit represents a squad or a platoon or whatever. No, it's just you're looking at the map and you see this one dude or dudette. That's it. That's your character. So, of course, you're going to start role-playing. It's more personal when you have one unit on the map, and it's you, basically. You're not controlling it. It's you. You're it. So it makes sense that a role-play rule comes about when you zoom in on an individual on the battlefield, and you've been reading some fantasy novels, maybe watching some weird Italian sci-fi and fantasy movies from the early 60s, and you start thinking, hey, wait a minute. We could do this. We can make a game using these fantasy characters. It's just, I don't know, it's college, years of college, years of war history. People, you know, Vietnam was over. It's like, what are we going to do now? Well, fantasy? You know, then of course Star Wars comes out, space opera. Everyone wants to do space opera, right?
Games. And I think that's in the DNA in a lot of cases. You can see it straight, right, winding through. So it makes sense that there's a whole bucket of games that carry that legacy forward. Is it a good reason to? No, it's not a good reason to play a heavy game to go, well, I just want to do what these guys did 40 years ago. 40 years? 50 years?
I don't think there were any after MASH. And after A Bridge Too Far, I don't think there were any war movies. Yeah, The Wind and the Lion. Kind of a war movie, kind of. But then, what happened? People got tired of wars, war stuff. You know, in the 60s, there seemed to be a war movie coming out every week. But the cowboy things ended, the war things ended. I was like, okay, what kind of movies are there now? Well, blockbuster movies. People were hoping that Conan the Barbarian would be the next blockbuster. Movies like, Dragon Slayer. They were coming out. Movies about, I don't know, like a main character who's on a quest. That became a fascination in the late 70s, early 80s. And I want to say it came to a head when Willow came out. That was the peak, the epitome of that kind of storytelling, movie genre. Got the one character on a quest. Willow's like one of the most perfect movies ever. It's just, it's for all ages. It's got something for everybody. Some would argue, no, it was Legend. Legend was better. there's other movies around that time. Some people like Gremlins. I don't know. I don't think Gremlins counts as a quest film.
Years ago, I mean,
me, I like Quest for Fire. I like that one.
You know, do you care? And the answer is no, you shouldn't. You should play the game you want to play, of course. But I think it's a decent explanation if you wanted to know why we're here. Because we started here. we're here because that's what the games always have been. And I don't know that they would have. And the funny part is, so you were effectively seeing Darwinism at work a little bit, I think, in that kids were always playing let's pretend make believe, but none of that was commercially viable. There's no way D&D exists today if it was a rules light game. There are simulations, like they have done sort of, you know, right, diplomatic and war
game. Well, a rules light game would just be board game. You know, here's the board, here's the dungeon pieces, you know, you got creature monsters, and here's your dragon piece. And you move around on the board. Sort of like Stratego or Battleship. That could have happened. Who would be the first then to make a role-playing game? A so-called role-playing game. These are not role-playing games. These are just glorified board games with dice, mostly dice games. Something to do until the home computer gets more advanced so you can play these on your home computer.
Gamey sims that are just a referee and their rules light, and that the referee adjudicates all of the moves, etc. But those existed before D&D, the earliest incarnations of D&D. But those weren't commercially viable. I think it took a game with rules, you know, a book of rules. Now, not a lot of rules. D&D, basic D&D, Blue Book D&D was not a, and be before that, the three white books, we'll call them, the beige books.
In the 70s, there was the zeitgeist that was going on. And Gary Gygax, he was like in a perfect storm, releasing these D&D books. What is it, 77, 78, 79? Around that time frame, he was releasing the AD&D books. It was the perfect storm. People were interested in this kind of stuff. And he won because he was first. He was the first to do it. The basic stuff in the boxes was being sold at Sears and Kmart. So he won. You know, the basic rules were literally basic. I guess you could call those light rules. I would call those medium rules. The red and blue boxes. I don't think there is a light version of D&D.
What? They're not super heavy. They're not. But not, at least not compared to today. Not compared to Champions 5th Edition, which I have somewhere on my shelf.
It's black with a green text. I want to say this one, but that looks too big.
Look for whatever is gravity. It's up there, actually. You can see it right there.
Oh, okay. That's it, then.
Look for whatever gravity is pulling all the other books into it. you know, I don't consider early editions of D&D to be super rules heavy, but they were rulesy in the sense that, you know, you were playing by a set of rules. It wasn't make believe. It was, you know, it wasn't, hey, let's pretend. It was no. You're doing this. You're playing by these rules. There is a pretend aspect to it in the sense that these rules only cover so much of what you can do, and then the GM has to adjudicate everything else. But when the crap hit the fan and you were fighting, you're playing by these rules, and you can, you know, and I think that's what it took to actually get us to this point. I think if you made if you powered by the apocalypse in 1975 or something, you don't get here. It never becomes as popular. And so I think what you're seeing is a natural evolution of, you know, certain lines of games and the ones that.
Okay, powered by the apocalypse doesn't come from war games. So how would you make the leap from Wargamer to powered by the apocalypse gamer? I don't think you could. Powered by the apocalypse is garbage. It's just trash. People that play it, they play it because they don't like D&D. That's the only reason to play powered by the apocalypse, because you don't like D&D. Which is one of the worst reasons to play some other game system.
That sort of, and it only makes.
Yeah, you don't play it because you like it. You play it because you hate D&D.
Makes sense, I think. Again, this is just opinion. It only makes sense that the games then got heavier. If that makes sense, you know, from D&D, and we go, wow, this is really cool.
Yeah, war gamers were still writing RPGs, so. Yeah, they're going to get crunchy, just like their war games would get crunchy. They want realism. You know, movies like Excalibur were coming out. They seemed to be dark and gritty. People wanted that in their games. It looked Hollywood, middle evil, high fantasy, low fantasy, whatever you want to call it. But it was like, I don't know, just the forests were dark and grimy and grimy. Witches were up to no good. Children were orphans and their hearts being used to power horrendous. Anyway, let's continue.
I love this. You're not going to take stuff away. You're going to go, man, I wish I had 8 more classes and 100 more spells. And, You know, I really wish a two-handed sword and a dagger had something to differentiate them meaningfully other than just a little bit of damage. And what happens if I...
It all comes down to the crit table. How many ways can you die? The descriptions of the ways you can die. And then you've played the game enough to where you've rolled on all those results. All 100 results. And you're bored. It's like, oh, I killed him that way. Oh, I've... Okay. So your leg comes off, blood splatters everywhere. And then my next thrust takes your head off. Oh, here's a result. I use my weapons as basically an auto machete, and I turn you into mince meat with my fists of death / antimedium fingernail, whatever. After a while, it's like, oh, here's one. I do the fist of death, and you died of a heart attack. So like I said, once you played the game enough times that you've read every single death move critical hit result on the chart, is it called surprise? Like when you read a book and you know, that was a good book. Are you going to read it again? Because you know the ending. That's how some of these games were. It's like, are we going to play this again? Because we all know how things end for either you or the bad guy in combat. Because we've all read how people die in the game. Now, if you're just going to play combat in these games, which most first-gen games are, is just combat. People get bored. Especially if they're min-maxers, which means they've read the rules and they understand the rules and they use all the rules. So they know what a good build is to kill certain other builds. And they get bored. Players get bored. It's like, oh, hum. It's no more surprise. Or they get nostalgia for something. They say, oh, that was such a cool game. Let's play it. And after a few hours, they're like, this is boring. What else is there to do? Same old, same old. Or worse, they say, oh, this game did not age well.
I attack you from behind. And, right, I mean, I think it's only natural that you got from basic D&D to advanced D&D to games like GURPS and Hero. I think it's all very natural progression.
Well, not many people had D&D from the early or from the mid 70s. Hardly anyone had that game. When AD&D came out, that's when, you know, television is talking about it.
From, I love this thing. Wouldn't it be cool if I did this other thing with that? And wouldn't that be cool? And so on and so forth. And some of that natural evolution then makes games heavier. And again, you could see that into the 80s with games like Aftermath and Space Opera. And I'm naming a lot of FGU games. And Hero System. And I think also you could see then...
No mention of Traveler? No mention of RuneQuest?
Where some folks would go, I sort of love this, but man, I don't love slogging through to an hour of combat. What if we cut this down? Or, you know, I want to tell a different type of story. What if we cut this, change this?
Tell a different kind of story? What the hell is that about? How did we get to there? We went from wargaming to heavy rules to I want to tell a story.
It's the paradigm. And so that's where you see this rules light set of games then also come to fruition. I think you're just seeing a very natural evolution of people going, wow, I love this thing. let's do this. Let's change it.
I love this thing. I want to tell a story with it. Those were the hippies. Those were the hippies doing the MJ stuff. And their hippie girlfriend could not be killed no matter what. Her character could not be killed.
Because that's also been part of the legacy of the hobby, part of the legacy of tabletop games, which is...
Okay, the point was the dungeon master wanted to sleep with the girl in the game. That's all it was about. You know, the weirdos with the long hair and the beard. They just, you know, they're groupies. They just wanted to have sex with the pretty girl that showed up to the game. And of course, the pretty girl was already taken all the time. All the time. But nerds, were, you know, they think, this time she will be mine. No, she's just showing up to play her special snowflake, one-of-a-kind snowflake character. And she'll leave. She'll leave the game if you kill off her character.
One of the reasons I say that I love the OSR, even though I don't love the games, is I love the homebrew aspect of them. I love the idea that they're taking something they love, which is often basic D&D or old versions of D&D, and then making one twist or two twists or some very clever, and bam, and now we have a new OSR game.
Well. It's like, I like this Western. I'm going to change just a little bit and make my own Western. So there's going to be like 1 million Western movies and 500,000 Western TV shows. But they're all basically the same.
That's natural. That's what this hobby was about and is still about, I feel. So I think legacy has a big part in it. Not that that should compel you to...
Now, OSR is all about... I'm going to get rich writing an RPG. That's what OSR is, using ordinary system rules.
Do it, but I think what you're seeing, the current state of, hey, we got some light games and a lot of heavy games, and why do people seem to like this one and don't like these ones as much? You know, why are heavy games more popular? I think a lot of that comes down to simply the legacy of D&D.
Heavy games are popular if you hang out in the heavy games forums and discords. Light games are popular if you hang out in the light game forums and discords.
Where it started and how it evolved over time. The next one is, oh, I didn't say, so you get a, my graphics are really cheesy. Next one is just preference, gamer preference. So, I play with a lot of different folks. I play with an old school wargamer guy, his wife, who never played a war game in her life, does play, you know, board games, but we're talking Catan and Roll for the Galaxy, games like that. Not
Cosmic Encounter.
You know, not Pacific War or
Twilight Imperium.
Enemy at the Gates, right? That's not her game. I play with a guy who wouldn't touch a war game in his life, but loves Magic Realm. But, you know, and I play with, again, another, you know, sort of war gamer. I play with a bunch of, I play with my kids, and I play with Jeff's kids. And again, you know, a lot of these kids have never played a war game. My kids have never played a Hex Encounter war game. You know, Eclipse... Magic Realm is probably the height of complexity that most of my kids have ever touched. But again, that's not even Hex and Count war game, right? So My point is we have a lot of different folks. But I think the driving preference, and by driving preference, I mean there's always, I think in any group, we have 8 people at the table. 9 if you count me.
That's too many.
I think there's always one or two or three people that drive any given table. Like, those are the preferences that move the game and other.
Okay, do round robin. So everyone is forced to take a turn. Problem solved. You don't have to worry about, oh, this person does all the talking. This person never says a word during the game. No, round robin.
Folks tend to follow along. You very rarely do you get a proper, like a true quorum or...
Well, you need a social contract. First of all, you want to vet your players. You want players who will roleplay, who are there to roleplay. I mean, I'm assuming this is roleplay, right? If you're playing a board game, you don't really need a social contract. If you're doing something else, if you're playing a board game but you're not using a board and you're not using pieces and you're letting players just go willy-nilly, so some people keep taking their turns over and over again while some players just sit there and they're not even involved in the game, that's the crappiest board game ever. And it's not a role-playing session either. So is it just therapy? Is this just an AA meeting where people get to talk in turns, sort of? Talk out of turn? While other people in the circle just sit there and contemplate their navels?
Certainly not a unanimous verdict on different things and different mechanics and so on. People like different things about games and tables. People dislike different things about games and tables. But I think you always have, in most social groups and in most gaming tables for sure.
Here we go. People talk about everything except role play at the table. Isn't that weird? They'll talk about everything. I like social interaction. I like going to my friend's house and eating his pizza. No one ever talks about role play because they don't role play. It's a big red flag right there. People that don't say role play in their videos about role-playing games, they don't role-play.
One or two or three preferences. A lot of times that's a GM, but just often is not. There's a couple players that also dictate that, and I think our preference...
People like RuneQuest will say play. They won't say role-play, they'll say play. Games that I play. Playing the game. They don't say role-play. They avoid that term.
At our table. So let's change this from gamer preference to table preference. Oops, that was the wrong place to type shit. And I think our preference, if you ask Scott, if you ask me for sure, I think maybe Jeff, is that I like the idea of having a man-to-man tabletop war game, fantasy table, right? I want a man-to-man war game. I want, you know...
Ragnarok. You want Ragnarok. You want Necromancer. You want, you know, your army's on the north, my army's on the south. We go head-to-head. It's a two-hour game. There's going to be victory points involved.
I want to play Firepower or Ambush. And have it meaning, have a campaign that lasts for however long, right? Why? I want an Uber Legacy war.
Just do one game. Just okay, war games, right? You play with your friend a war game, someone's house. 4 hours later, the game's over, and everyone's like, "Wow, that was so close! I didn't know who was gonna win at first," you know. You play one game. You don't do a campaign of the same war game. You don't. Why would you do a war game? I mean, why would you do a campaign of a game session where half the players don't even talk in the game? Like, why do they show up every week? And nobody's role playing. Nobody is. And there's a campaign of that? Why?
board game. Like, I want to play Gloomhaven, but not with card rules. I want, you know, I want a tactical man-to-man fantasy war game. But
you got Hero, do it with Hero. If you have GURPS, you do it with GURPS. If you just want combat. They're generic enough, you can use your own settings in these things.
I want a story around it. And I want the story.
Oh, he wants a story. What happened? When I was a kid, they were called frustrated writers. They wanted to tell a story to their friends. So, of course, they're going to have a campaign. Because they want their stories long-winded. They want their players to hear all of it. All of the story. Even if the player's doing nothing in the game, the GM's going to tell you the story and is going to tell you what your character's doing. If you don't tell me what your character does, I will tell you, I will say for you what your character's doing in my story. That's how these fuckers run their games for 40 years now. The 99%ers out there. Emmett, some guy named Emmett, posted a comment yesterday on a video of mine. That's how he role plays. To tell a story to his players. It's the fucking weirdest thing ever.
Great to weave through those fight scenarios. I want the fight scenarios to have a reason. I want them to have a meaning. I want the ramifications to have a meaning. I want the downtime, the in-between time to have.
What downtime? What do you need downtime for? To organize what you're going to read next to your players? You know, the players, you know, spoiler alert, the players are in downtime during the game, the entire game. What more downtime do the players need? They're not talking during the game, so. You just want them to turn off their imagination. You want them to stop daydreaming. Most players are just daydreamers at the table. You want them to stop daydreaming. That's the downtime. Ay, ay, ay. How about this? If you want your scenes to be meaningful, how about you roleplay the stuff? How about you roleplay your NPCs for a change? How about the players roleplay their characters for a change? That's meaningful. Oh, but you want everything to work out the way your story did? I wrote this story. I want you to go through it with me. It's part of my therapy.
A meaning, and I want it all to tie together. So, the fact that every so often we break into one plus.
So there's something mentally wrong. When you want to tell a story to your friends at the table and you're going to force them to go through your heavy mechanic rules to reveal the story, hoping they make their die rolls. Otherwise, you're frustrated because you're trying to tell them a story and they keep failing their die rolls.
Our war games in the middle of our tabletop role-playing session is a feature and not a bug. I suppose, is what I'm
trying to tell a story to my player friends, but the war game keeps getting in the way, and my players get frustrated and bored because they don't like war games, but we're playing rules as read.
Trying to get at. I think a lot of folks on the other side, right, once they have that revelation, they become story game guys, or they become light, rules light guys, they think that...
So the frustrated writers finally decide, you know what, enough with these heavy rules, let's go with the light rules so I can tell my story properly to my players. Does that work either? I don't think that works either. Because these light rules do not necessarily mean better rules or more efficient rules. You're still dealing with the crap die roll mechanics that most games have, especially if it's first gen nonsense. You know, oh, I'm using light rules now. There's less crunch. Well, is it a role-playing game, though? Is it second gen? Is it a second gen RPG, at least? Is it? Because to even roll, if you're trying to role-play, I am. I'm one of those guys that role-plays, which is weird, I know. Hardly anyone role-plays in the hobby. I use a second gen RPG because that allows for role-play. Now, if I'm going to be telling a story to my players, I'll just read a book to my players who don't have to play anyway. They can just sit at my table and I'll read a story to them. I'll have them choose a page that I start reading from. I'll have them choose the name of the character in my story. I'll have them choose if my character takes the left path or the right path going down a forest. I'm going to read them the story. I'm going to tell them all the amazing things that their characters do. Do I need rules for that? Fuck no. Why do I hide or pretend or use some weird pretense that we're here to play this game when actually I just want to read you a fucking story? I trapped you into my house so I can read you my fucking story. I conned you into thinking we're going to play this weird dice game, the weird shaped dice games. All I really want to do is tell you my story. There's something mentally ill with people like that. And the people that show up week after week at these people's houses, there's something mentally ill with them too as well.
That they see that long, complicated combat to be a bug. That's a problem to be solved. Why are you doing that? You can't be having fun. And the answer is no. That's the point. I want a miniatures war game inside my tabletop role-playing game. And I don't necessarily have any preference for which is more important. I think that shifts over time. I think that shifts different nights, and I think that shifts during the night.
I want to know how long would he last in someone's war game? He shows up to a guy's house, they're going to play a war game, but he wants to role play. He wants there to be a story. His friend's going to say, get the fuck out.
But I want that in there. I want that. I want to role play. I want to hang out. I want to tell a story. I want to, you know, whatever, hang out at the bar or have my guys tromping through the swamp as they head to Mount Doom. I want all that. I want Samwise to cast loving glances over at Frodo. But I want a flanking bonus. I want to know that this type of armor and this type of weapon, how they go against one another. Like, oh, you should not be using a slashing weapon. That dude has plate armor on. That ain't going to work.
I like it when the players role play their characters and they know about this kind of stuff and they enjoy role playing that situation with their character. It's challenging for them. It's rewarding for them. If the game master has to tell the player, now be careful, these two things, they don't work together, so you're going to have this penalty and you're going to have this. The player doesn't care. They're just chewing bubblegum. And they just want to be entertained. That's what they're there for, and suck down your Mountain Dew. The player's basically, fine, whatever. Just tell me what I need to roll. I'll roll the dice and I'll tell you what number it is. Because at the end of the day, that's all the game master wants, really, is human die rollers at his table. That's all they do is roll dice. Every time it's their turn, they're fucking rolling dice.
Or chainmail. Maybe you should thrust and stab him and pierce through that. Those are the kind of things I want to see. I love that. I want all those other things, but I want the fact that I am standing next to an ally with a shield and he has to matter. I want that to matter. So long story short, it's a feature, not a bug. If you tell me, wow, I can't believe that you guys had a night where literally it was the set piece boss battle.
This is why you would read in the early 80s. This is why you read game reviews in these tabletop magazines. You wanted to know, when you're 18 years old, you just want to know, is the game fun? Is it at least fun? Is the game a chore? Are there a lot of chart lookup tables? Are there a lot of opening the book when it's your turn? Are the rules convoluted? Does it play like a war game? You know, what's the point of the game? What does the game do that other games don't do already? And you got the forever game buyer. That's the guy who buys every RPG that ever comes out. You know, they have all the free league games. They have all the Modiphius games. All these are coffee table art books with some crap rules interspersed into the book. But it's mostly coffee table artwork. And the buyers of these things, the RPG collectors, are never satisfied. They're still looking for the perfect game. They need to ask themselves, what is it they're looking for? And just do that. Why are they trying to get an RPG, a so-called RPG book, to be their cure-all? Maybe they're in the wrong hobby. Maybe they should just be buying coffee table art books. Because they're never going to play the game. They're never going to find someone to be in the game. They're never going to, you know, there's a group of people that refuse to play online because they think playing online is weird or it doesn't work. That could be true. It's hard to be in an online game where no one has their cameras on. You're doing a podcast. You're recording a podcast of a game's anyway. It's just weird. Then some people get carried away with their cameras and they do the Hollywood Squares game version of whatever session they're supposedly role playing, but it's mostly just Hollywood Squares, everyone gets to tell a joke in their box for the viewing audience to listen to. Nobody's playing a game. Yesterday I was watching Misfits. The Misfits were playing Star Trek Adventures. It was one of the worst Star Trek anything game sessions I've ever seen on YouTube. And this Misfit girl, she always, you know, every week she comes out with a video talking about how, you know, GM tips. She's always giving out GM tips. And her game was just trash. I think she was a player in the game, but it was hosted on her channel. It was garbage. Absolute garbage. No role play. Everyone's telling a joke. No one's in character. There was no in-character talking. Half the players didn't know the rules to the game. Half the players didn't know what Star Trek even was. They were all D&D. They're all D&D 5e players in a Star Trek game for some reason. It was horrific. Absolute trash.
Battle, and it took 4 hours. That sounds horrible. Or does it sound wonderful? And for me, for us.
Yeah, combat. I don't mind combat. It just needs to be real time. How long does combat take in a movie? Or a TV show? That's how long it should be in my game, right? We're doing real time? Now, obviously, if there's a war going on and it takes place, you know, it takes 30 years or something, then, yeah, the whole, I guess, if your point of view is the battlefield, I guess you're always going to be fighting and in combat. Just play a video game. Just do that on the computer. Why try to do that with paper and pencil?
Us, I think, and for the table, I think, and we've had those nights. We've had those nights. And I love it, right? And the table loves it. And we.
What do you love about it? The XP that you get? What's the point? What's the reward? Would you want to go to the theater and watch 7 hours of Lord of the Rings battle? And it's slow as fuck? One guy hits and then he stands there while someone else takes their turn? Would you sit and watch that movie?
Love it. That is the preference. It's funny because, so I've written also a superhero game. And I bristle.
What did I say earlier about frustrated writers?
Bristle a tiny bit, and don't care. I'm long past caring. I have no interest in arguing over at the internet. But I do like making these videos, and I do like talking to folks, and I do like comments. So there you go. There's your like, subscribe, comment, a call to action. Right where the YouTube wanted to put it. No, just kidding. Oh, not the YouTube, I'm sorry. Right where ChatGPT wanted to put it. I screwed that joke up. But I have superhero game, and get to surprise, it is a tactical miniature superhero combat game, and then there's RPG mechanics lightly wrapped around it. And I bristle.
Why do people put RPG rules in their combat games? Why? Just make a combat game. Just make a superhero combat board game.
A tiny bit when people go, well, I mean, you should play masks because superhero games aren't about fighting. They're like soap operas, and they're about all the interpersonal stuff. And then, and I go, hold on. No. I mean, yes, they can be about all that stuff. But they can also be about the fighting. We have.
Yeah, find out if someone wrote a superhero RPG, first thing you do, ask them, what comic books did they read? What comic books do they like to read? Find out first. It's like people that do space games. Find out, what is it about real space that they like? See if they even know what space even is. Ask them what their favorite sci-fi movie is before you buy their space game. Anyway, if you have a decent RPG mechanic, you know, die mechanics, skill-based roleplay rules, you can do supers, you can do fantasy, you can do sci-fi, you can do western, you can do cyberpunk. You can do anything. But for whatever reason, people that don't understand this, they want to make the setting the system, the system the setting. It's like, okay, here's a system. It only does this one thing, and it does it very mediocre, in a very mediocre fashion, but it works. So we're using it for this one setting it can do. And if the game gets popular enough, the author sweats bullets trying to figure out how to make the rules work with other settings. And what they'll do is they'll just change the rules for each setting book. If they luck out and they think ahead, like total party skills, they end up with a mechanic that works with pretty much any genre. So when they release any genre, they don't have to rewrite new rules. They use existing rules. Those are second gen RPGs, by the way. Ones that work with any genre.
There's a reason why people obsess over who would win between whatever, Batman and Aquaman. I mean, theoretically, Batman wins every fight because they've written him.
Yeah, well, it's nice to think about such things, but if you're just using a crap D20 die roll mechanic, yeah, it's just luck. Who wins?
There's some kind of god genius. But having said that, there's a reason why when two heroes meet, in a lot of times in the comic books, the first time they meet, they have to, one of them has to misrecognize or miss as a villain, and they have to fight for a while because we're obsessed, you know, comic book fans, we're obsessed with how character X stacks up against character Y. Why isn't combat an important part of?
Comic books are about conflict and drama. And then there's these unwritten rules about how the heroes never kill anybody. I don't know if that's still the case. But for the most part, the heroes never die and they never kill anybody. So good luck making an RPG based on that kind of a setting.
A superhero tabletop role-playing game, right? So I think a lot of that has to do with preference, and our table's preference is, yeah, I want a four-hour freaking combat every so often. Karen, who plays our game, she gets antsy if we're not fighting. If we have a whole night where we're not fighting, she's like, why did I show up? What are you doing? What are you doing to me? Are you trying to put me to sleep? Come on, let's get to it. And so,
yeah. Women don't like guys sitting around doing nothing for 4 hours. That's boring as fuck. And if she only sees excitement when the guys are doing combat, then she's interested. The slow-paced part is probably agonizing for her because no one can role-play in the group. She might want to role play, but no one else knows how to role play or cares about it. She would go nuts sitting at a table with a bunch of nerds contemplating their navels because there's no combat happening. And they don't do anything else if there's no combat. And the Mother May I game sessions get very boring really quick for women who showed up to, you know, do something. This is a game you play, right? Women are very good at Monopoly. They're very good at Clue. When it's their turn, guess what? They take their turn. They're not like, oh, is it my turn yet? No, they don't do that shit. Games tend to go fast. They don't take forever to do their turn. So you invite women over to your RPG game night each Friday night, and your fat neckbeard friends don't do much except mess around with their fanny packs. And whenever it's their turn to roll dice, every fucking one of them acts like they've never rolled dice before. Just watch in any actual play. When it's someone's turn to roll dice, they always act like, oh, hang on, where's my dice? What do I roll? And then you tell them what they roll, and you wait for them to roll, and it's painful. And you think, oh, okay, it's just, they haven't played for a while. They're getting back into the groove. No, this fucking every time it's their turn in the same game, they do this.
So I do think that there is a place for, hey, I want to bust some heads. And rules-heavy games are great for busting heads. The third one is shared rules. And this is one where people go, well, you have a bad GM. Like, if you had a good GM, you wouldn't worry about that because you wouldn't need to have these mechanics out there. And the answer is, well, sure. I mean, look, there is a level of trust that I think you have with your GM to assume he's going to adjudicate the world correctly and so on.
I don't know what shared world rules is. The players get to help define the world using the GM's rules? What? I don't know what that means. Are you sharing your world with other game tables?
Having said that, it's very hard. Even the best, most fair, you know, most cinematically minded GM is going to have trouble if you continuously ask them to have to come up with the exact set of consequences or the exact adjudication, right? He's not real. We're not really simulating that in your head. He's making arbitrary decisions, right? Your GM probably doesn't know anything about stealth or martial art. I mean, he might. I'm not saying he doesn't, but I'm saying
players don't have to know anything. Their characters have to know the things. You guys aren't playing second gen rules, right? You're not playing second gen RPGs. You're playing first gen RPGs. First gen RPGs, the players have to know everything. The characters are just stats. You know, bingo sheets. Second gen games, the players don't necessarily need to be rocket scientists or brain surgery types, but their characters would know that shit, right? Most players don't know how to decapitate someone, but Conan, he knows.
Most, just on statistically, if I pick a topic, your GM doesn't know shit about this. Let's understand that. So he's making arbitrary decisions based on limited experience, and he's trying his best. And that's what they're doing, right? And
yeah, it's when the GM says, well, actually, you wouldn't be able to swing the sword hard enough to cut through the rock, you know, or you wouldn't know how to tie the rope tight enough for it to lift all those logs out of the river, you know, something like that. Or you can't swing from that vine with all the weight loaded up on your back. The vine would snap, you know. And everyone's like discussing pros and cons for everything before they actually decide what they want to do on their turn. Women hate that shit.
So it's one of those things where you go, well, I mean, if we just go with this arbitrary stream of consciousness decision-making process, then the decisions at some point will be inconsistent, or they will be unfair, they will maybe not make sense at times, and so
on. Yeah, watch any Survivor episode. You got the guys and the girls on the island. The guys are always haggling about, well, if we're going to make homemade concrete out of these coconuts, we need to have a level ground for our foundation. We need some chalk to draw the line, where to pour our jungle-made concrete. Because before we build the hut, we need to have a solid floor to stand on. And then they're arguing, well, this one fat ass, he breaks the foundation every time he steps on it. So they're going to make him sleep outside the hut. He's not allowed in the hut. Meanwhile, the women want to cook food. Some other guys have caught fish or shark or whatever, eggplant. They want to cook the food, but they don't have the stove even put together yet, and it's going to be dark soon. And that's when the mosquitoes attack. So you have, you know, Like, they always pull one of the people aside and film their little private confession scene. I like it when they do that on Survivor. It just, you know, people at home want to know what each person's thinking while in Survivor mode.
So on and so forth. If you have a game in the middle of you, an honest to goodness set of rules, and someone asks me, well, what's my chance to pick that dude's pocket? I'm no longer making an arbitrary decision. We both know what the chance is to pick his pocket.
Okay. Let's say the player is role-playing in a setting. And let's say the player character knows how to pick pockets, is a thief, basically. The player doesn't need to ask anyone any questions. The player just needs to say what they're trying to do on their turn. That's it. That's it. Make a roll. If the character's any good at it, they'll succeed. You don't have to ask the GM questions. Can I pickpocket this person? Even if the player character is not a thief, and for whatever reason, it makes sense, he's in character and he wants to pickpocket somebody because this is what's required in the situation at hand, and the player character has no skill whatsoever in pickpocketing, has never stolen in their life, never tried pick. That's intense. And it's really cool to roleplay that situation. And the dice are going to tell you what's going to happen next, based on the skill of your character, who's never pickpocketed anyone ever.
Oh, you're a fourth level thief, so it's 28% or whatever that the damn table is in Advanced D&D, or in, you know, in Runebearer.
fourth level thief. Yeah, you're not role-playing a character in those games. You're role-playing a class, but you can't role-play a class. You can't role-play an automaton.
My game, it's like, well, the DL is 10. What's your skill? Oh, my skill is 10 also. Well, you have about a 54% chance of succeeding. Would you like to get it right? Would you like to try?
By the way, what he's saying happens on every turn. Every fucking turn. And these guys have been playing the same shit for decades. And they still have this conversation every time it's someone's fucking turn. It's like, what, was your mind wiped since last game session? Do we have to explain this to you every time it's your turn? Yes. That's how we play. You have to have some brain damage to play this game to begin with. So obviously you're going to have issues like this during the game. Because brain damage.
Would you like to try to convince me of a modifier? You know, right? Let's get a modifier. Is there any way that we can distract him? Or right, that whole thing.
A player chooses through the help of a committee decision, a group effort. It takes a village. No child left behind nonsense. That's how people do these game sessions. It's group therapy. I'm so glad I have you as my friends. Otherwise, I would never make it through this game session.
There's a shared rules. How much damage will I take if I jump from this 30-foot ledge onto concrete? Good. Maybe good to know that, right? And the answer is, well, if you have a set of rules, then you at least have a basis for...
This is why you have those old YouTube videos from 10 years ago where the game masters would ask, as a game master, do you hand wave? In your game sessions, how often do you hand wave? You know, players doing things in your game. The reason why the GMs ask this question is exactly because of this. What the fuck are you guys doing in the game? You know, just because Gary Gygax didn't roleplay doesn't mean nobody needs to roleplay. Gary Gygax was selling books. Does that mean everyone else needs to be selling books?
understanding what your chance of success is, what possible consequences of failure are, even if there isn't a specific rule for the thing you're asking, there might be a framework there that the GM can utilize to then make the decision. Hero system is great for this. You don't need a rule for everything. Hero pretty much.
Yeah, Hero's great. That's why it belongs on a computer. GURPS is great. That's why it belongs on a computer in a video game. The D100 die roll mechanic is great. That's why it belongs on a computer. In other words, Hero system is so great, no one plays it. Really, no one. Maybe 100 people on Earth even look at the book. Ever.
Much as you covered, you can go, well, I think what's going to happen is when you shoot that tank of volatile gas, it will explode for 8d6 explosion damage. And now you know exactly what that's going to do to the thug's stand.
The first gen games have a mini rule for each rule. So you look up, okay, I want to do heavy explosives or something. How does that work? Oh, well, based on your skill, you have access to these kinds of explosives and blah, blah, blah. And these are the areas of effect for each explosion from these weapons. It's very painful. Very painful reading those books. And then to sit there and try to play the game by the book.
Ending around it. Not exactly, because it's dice, you're rolling. But you know what I mean. You have a good idea. So I do think that there is value in having a shared framework of what's my chance of success, what are my consequences for failure, and we both know that. And you're not just making it up.
Yeah, role players don't think about, oh, what's my percentage of failure or success? They just roleplay. And role players are prepared for whatever the result may be. I mean, one could say it doesn't matter if they fail or succeed. Because they're just roleplaying. They're just roleplaying. It doesn't matter if they fail or succeed with their role. It's just role-playing. The die rolls make things interesting is all. It makes things more interesting to role-play. Role-playing gets boring if you're not rolling dice.
And you're not being asked to continuously be a physics engine and a, you know, social arbiter and a, right, that whole thing. And there's a place for that, and obviously even, you know, as you get, I mean, that's one of the things, by the way, that OSR folks often talk about. They go, well, you have all these games, and everything's defined. So, you know, if you write a rule for it, then that rule also excludes other people from trying to do the thing. If you have a talent, which is +1 to put a bucket on someone's head, I don't know where that came from, but that implies that everybody else doesn't have that +1. Or if you have a talent which allows you to trip someone, it implies that no one else can trip anyone. And I agree with that. I think that's one of the difficulties with games like Pathfinder 1st Edition, and 3rd, D&D 3, with the feat-based builds. I do think that you have the issue of well, in old D&D, I would try to trip someone and the GM would just figure that out and make that up, and old school games, you know, lighten up that, right? They're way more rules light than a lot of these later games like Advanced D&D, Hero, etc. And the idea in doing that is to allow you to do more things, and the GM wings it, and that's okay. Ruling's not rules, and I'm good with that too, but I think that a shared framework, regardless of how heavy that framework might be, is very useful. So maybe that third one doesn't really say, hey, you know, you should be rules heavy. I prefer, you know, as my preference, I'm going to prefer rolls heavy. I'm going to prefer to know, hey, you know, you're flanking unless you get a thing, as opposed to.
I mean, it's a trap. A lot of people in the hobby find themselves. They don't know how to role play. Their friends don't role play, so they need more rules in their game systems to adjudicate things. Because there's a lack of role play in their game sessions. Players don't know what they're supposed to do because they're not role playing what their character would do. So they look in the book and they see all these things you can do when it's your turn. Most of the stuff you can do on your turn is combat. So it's a combat game. They might not even get to the part where, oh, there's social combat? You know, that kind of thing. All they know is, you know, guns, guns, guns. Because they see that in the rules.
Someone asking me, well, what does it mean if I'm flanking? Because there's no rule for it. And then me going, plus one, right? Or whatever. I prefer having that laid down for me and giving me then. And then later, if something hits where I don't have a rule, I can go, well, a lot of these modifiers are plus two. Why don't I just give you a plus two for that also? Right?
Instead of a player, okay, a role player wouldn't say, I'm going to flank. A role player will say what their character is doing. And role play solves everything. So just having the player role play saves so much time. You know, asking questions back and forth. What are you doing? What is it you're trying to do? What's your goal here? What do you... If the player's role-playing, it's obvious what the player's intent is with their character. It's like players will say, I'm going to use my opportunity of it. Was it opportunity to attack or something like that? Or I'm going to use my free attack move. I'm going to retreat and do my double defense attack move while I double retreat on my turn. You're just telling the GM what directions you're pushing the stupid joystick on the game console.
D&D 5th actually does this quite well. I mean, I don't love advantage and disadvantage as a mechanic, but it is a effective mechanic because the GM can just go, well, it sounds like you have advantage, or it sounds like you're going to have disadvantage. And that's the framework. Done. They win. It's not super heavy, but it does give you, you know, why do we have mechanics? Well, you got a shared set of rules. Another one, which I might be reaching.
Shared set of rules? That doesn't make sense to me. Wouldn't that be obvious? Wouldn't each player at the table have the same rules that they're using? I'm going to come into your game not only with a different character sheet than anyone else, but with a different game mechanic than everyone else. And I'm going to come into your table with a different game setting than everyone else.
I think these allow you to drill down on what's important, in the sense that, you know, if you look at, so this is the, my take on system matters kind of, right? It is saying that whatever rules you pick, you're going to drill down on things that are important. D&D 5th obviously thinks character builds are important and combat is important and, you know, spells and spell.
Yeah. XP. That game is about leveling up, zero to hero. That's the important thing. First thing role players do is they don't play those games. That's the sign of a role player right there. when they don't play Zero to Hero games and they don't play for XP. I mean, all role players know this.
Effects are important, and having those defined is very important. Third edition D&D is character builds are very important. You know, position is important. It's telling you what's important, right? The rules drill down on things that are important. And a lot of games, a lot of rules-heavy games, obviously feel combat is very important.
Yeah, they don't emphasize, it's weird, these games, the book titles, you know, the titles of the books all say role-playing game system. The role-playing game system. But then there's no role-play in any of the game sessions that use the rules. So that's bizarre. It's a marketing thing. People hear the term role-playing game on a book cover of something, they automatically assume, oh, it's a dice game, and you have character attributes, and maybe certain powers or something, and you have clothes and weapons. You have maybe a familiar that you can... Anyway. That's what people think when they see RPG on the cover of a book. And they all assume you're going to level up and, you know, Zero to Hero nonsense. Is any of that role-playing, though? Any of those mechanics, is that role-playing? No.
They drill down heavy on combat. Again, I don't know whether that's, oh, I think this is important, or whether it's just legacy a little bit, that every game seems to drill down on combat, so I'm going to write my game and drill down on combat, too. But if you look at, say, as a for instance...
The same thing happened with war games. How many Waterloo war games are there? How many Battle of the Bulge war games are there? How many Blitzkrieg war games are there? How many Barbarossa war games are there? Everyone wants to write their own version of it. They've played the war game, now they're going to write their own version of a war game. Now we're dealing with, I want to write an adventure to tell my players. And I've played all the games where you have an adventure that you read to your players. Well, I want to write my own adventure and read it to my players. That's where we're at now with these chuckleheads.
Early versions of D&D, and if you, for instance, look at, say, some OSR games, they shift that emphasis from combat. A lot of them do, and combat becomes simpler again. Oh yeah, we just roll initiative per side, and then you do a d20 and blah blah blah, and you hit or not hit. There's not that much position. We don't have all these bonuses flanking. You know, we cut those rules down, and then we focus on the.
And what's weird is that for decades, Dungeon Masters have been aching to tell a story to their players, and now they finally can. With D&D 5e, they finally can do it, because D&D 5e is a storytelling game. And this is the weird part. This is another weird part. For decades, these same Dungeon Masters have been saying that they hate storytelling games, but then they want to tell a story to their players. So which is it? And now they finally have a version of D&D that basically is a storytelling game. And all these old farts that have been around for 40 years, they hate it. They don't like 5e. But that's what they've secretly wanted to do. That's what they still try to do in whatever derivative game they play. Maybe it's not D&D anymore, but it's some fantasy thing. They're trying to tell a story to their players using less better rulage that doesn't really allow for storytelling, but they refuse to do the 5e thing because it's WotC for whatever reason. WotC is just making what these crap-ass gamers wanted for decades. It's just bizarre. It's just, the whole hobby is just, it's just cringe. So I've never belonged to the TTRPG community, never want to be in it. It's just cringe.
Mechanics, the specific mechanics of exploration, and we start telling the GM very specifically, hey, you know, every hour you mark a torch off, every 20 minutes you might roll a monster check, a wandering monster check.
Okay, if you're playing in real time, you would know it would make sense when the torch goes out. Heck, maybe a player says, hey, my torch just went out. Because it makes sense. You don't have to wait for the GM to say anything. A player can say, hey, it's out. Dun, dun, dun. You know, the player adds their own drama to themselves.
You know, there might be mechanics for resting and rations and resting safely and so on. And so, you know, I like rules heavy games.
I like it when a character goes to sleep. You know, it's midnight. They've been battered and bruised and they pass out half drunk on a carpet. You know, in their mid-priced hotel room with a hooker and who knows what else in the room. And when they wake up, the player says that they're naked and all their money's gone. And the key to their Porsche. You know, nothing about, oh, I'm all healed up, ready for another adventure today.
Because rules heavy games can, you know, can start to detail what is important to them and really get into it. So again, Runebearer, you know, combat is a thing and casting magic spells is a thing. And we have, and there are lots of rules for all of that. But as we play like a hex crawl or whatever, I pull out the rules for traveling, the rules for camping safely, and, you know, we detail down and we start having a little bit of a logistics discussion of, well, how many days of food is it going to be? It's,
oh my God, just have them go to sleep. Don't say, oh, let's check the rules and see if it's the safe space that you're sleeping in or not and what the chances of you being molested in your bedrolls are. Just, you know, fade to black and then fade to morning time. The sun's coming up. Everyone's waking up. Nothing happened. But no one's like well rested either. They were sleeping on in a marsh pit on rocks. There was constant wind chill factors keeping them frigid. Who knows? They wake up. Maybe their bodies are more stiff than when they went to bed. Aches and pains. And that's when, you know, the NPC nearby, his head just comes right off. The rest of his body is scattered to the winds while people are still rubbing their eyes getting up out of their bedrolls.
It's only a 3-day trip if your navigator gets you there in 3 days. And if your pathfinder can avoid hazards and your scouts can detect any incoming enemies ahead of time.
Yeah, before the players go to sleep, every player says what they're going to do. They put their characters in autopilot. John usually says something like, well, I'll stay up and keep watch, and I'll be ready with my bow and laser beams, take out anything that might come near us that looks out of place or looks anything suspicious, I will take care of on my watch. I'll be doing all the things. I was like, if nothing's going to happen, just fade to black, fade to morning. Instead of asking every player, what are you going to do? I guess I'll sleep. I'll sleep first, I guess. I'll take the first watch. It doesn't really matter. The GM's going to read you a bedtime story anyway, so it doesn't fucking matter what the players really say.
And we drill down into that level because that becomes then important. And I, you know, and I like having that whole planning the trip to get from A to Z. And so I made that important in the game. And another thing which I find sort of interesting, but again, a lot of games don't do this, because all combat is, if you think about it, in D&D, combat is what I call a mini game. The actual base game is you roll a d20, add some stuff, and do you hit a DL? That's the base mechanic. All the mechanic other stuff in combat is actually a variation of that mechanic. It is a mini game. It is a set of rules tacked onto that mechanic.
You don't want a mini game.
And a lot of games, so for instance, D&D, original D&D was actually full of mini games, advanced D&D. You had, and barely had a base mechanic, by the way, but that's a different discussion, which is sort of fun.
Yeah, first generation RPG.
But
they suck. They all suck.
If you look at base, like the early versions of D&D, it's interesting because it's all mini games, really. Thieves had their own mini game. It's a percentage table, so it's a dull mini game. Combat was a mini game. Spell casting didn't really interface. Like you don't roll to spell cast. It wasn't part of a skill system or whatever. But you had this other set of rules then to follow. I had to memorize spells and write down my lists and so on. Psionics. Not that anyone that used psionics in AD&D, God bless you, but psionics mini game. You had a whole extra game for fighting psionically. Same thing with hand-to-hand combat, wrestling, and unarmed combat. You had a mini game for that. And each of those, now, to be honest with you, most people just ignored most of those rules. A lot of them were imbalanced and or nonsensical and didn't necessarily make for good play. They're not particularly good rules. Having said that, they drilled down into things that I believe the authors thought were important to drill down on. Oh, you know what? Presumably at some point someone said, I want to be a wrestler. And then someone wrote, you know what? We're going to write some wrestling rules. Let's do it. Because that's important. And I bet you they had a good time with those in the moment. Now, I wouldn't, again, use them because, again, they all sort of make no sense, really, in the context of the
Okay, wrestling is part of the problem. Wrestling is basically actors performing for an audience. Wrestling is fake. Why would you want that in an RPG? Why would you want your character to be a fake fighter who's performing for audiences? What the fuck character would that even be? You know, Hollywood would say, oh, we're going to use The Rock in our movie, you know, former wrestler. Yeah, former fake wrestler. He's famous for fake wrestling. He's going to be a tough guy in the movie. There's no wrestling in the movie. It's just he used to be a wrestler. That's what he's known for. Why would you have a wrestler character in an RPG game? It doesn't make any sense. I mean, would a wrestler actually do wrestling? Hell no. They don't want to get hurt. They can't work if they're broken.
A game of advanced D&D. But at some point, I think they felt they were important. I bet you they used them in some ways to do a thing. And again, someone enjoyed them. And probably one guy made a giant.
Now, cage fighters, they're for real. That's when you got like 20 guys and one guy's left because the other ones are either dead or broken. But wrestling, you don't want to hurt your playmate because you have a story arc for everybody and they have to follow along the script during the summer World Wrestling Federation tour.
Giant strength 18-00 big bear wrestler guy and kicked a lot of ass. But yeah. So for something like Runebearer, I like magic. So there's rules for, oh, let's make your own spell. How do those spells propagate to other mages?
Okay, what is he talking? What's the next topic? Different types of stories? Uh-oh.
Five, because I'm a good writer. Rules-heavy games allow you to tell different types of stories. I think that a lot of folks that go to the rules light, right? That they pound the rules light drum.
Yeah, guys like him will say, well, if you do a sandbox, literally a sandbox with just sand in it, then the players just stand there in the sandbox and they don't know what to do because there's no story.
And this is their preference. They get their own preference. They can play their game, and that's cool. But I think we focus on telling a certain type of story. I think a lot of videos and a lot of the gestalt of, you know, D&D community is we should be telling stories like novels or movies. That's a certain type of story, the narrative story, the cinematic story, we'll call it.
Where did that start? Where did this nonsense start from? Because I remember it back in 77, guys were doing their D&D games like that. They want to tell a story. They get the record out, they play the record, the music, whatever, trying to get the players into the mood, the tone, the setting, the theme, whatever. This music's going to help. And it was like, you know, Lawrence of Arabia, let's play the soundtrack. Ben-Hur, get out the soundtrack. Ten Commandments. Once in a while, a Western would play. Oh, no. You know, Aaron, what's the guy? Aaron Copland. Yeah, play some of his music. What's that one song they used to play in the Olympics back in 72 in Berlin? What was that one? The solo man or something is something about man. Just that was an Aaron Copland song. When you hear it, you'll be like, oh, that music. They played it at the Olympics all the time. Every time someone was getting a gold medal, they would play that music. Do I want to watch the rest of this? Yes.
Because I think we are conditioned to want to tell that type of story because we go and watch them. Everybody's all, I watch the Fallout.
Yeah, so music always gets people in the mood, apparently, at least the GM thinks that. Back then, there was no Game Master. It was only Dungeon Master. Yeah, get out the 8-track, start playing the music. What was another movie back? Oh, if Star Wars. Oh my God, I wish I had a dollar every time my friend Kevin would play Star Wars music. It's like, really? Again? We're going to do space opera. But he would always want to tell a story. He always wanted to tell a fucking story.
I want to tell a story like that. Or I watched, I don't know. I can't think of a good movie. I watched Lord of the Rings. I wish I could tell that story. Well, that's a weird.
Don't watch Zardoz. Otherwise, your friend down the street would want to, God forbid, LARP that stuff.
I don't know. Damn, what movie have I watched recently? That's the problem. I haven't watched any movies recently.
Now, I always ask players, what's their favorite sci-fi movie? What's their favorite Western movie? I'm a movies guy, so I'm going to ask players about movies. I want to hear from the players what their favorite movies are. Because especially if they're going to be making a character. I want them to pick a setting or know of a setting so that they can make a character for the setting. Usually if someone likes a movie, they usually like the setting. Because they'll say, Shonar, let's do a sci-fi game. And I say, okay, what kind of sci-fi game? What movies have you watched lately? And they'll mention a movie. Then already we both know what the setting looks like, what the characters are like. So right away we can start do some world building before we do a session zero. Just bouncing ideas off each other. You know, who's going to run the game? What's the theme about, the tone, the settings, the moods, that kind of thing? But we always start with, you know, some movie that one of us watched, so it's fresh in our head. Or maybe it's an old classic film that we haven't really role played in yet. Because a frame from one movie is 1,000 words, right? And how many frames are there in a movie? But we don't do the whole movie linguistics thing to tell a story. We're not trying to tell a story. There's an RPG of 2001, Space Odyssey. It's the worst RPG rules I've ever read. Absolute worst. You're actually running the game for players and you're trying to tell the story from 2001, A Space Odyssey using dice rolls and crap. Which the rules constantly say, well, make sure your players are at this scene location for this one scene in the story to take place. Don't make them roll dice if they're going to die early in the game because they won't be around for the rest of this, you know. Trying to tell the exact story in the movie? No, what I do is, it's the setting. You're the astronauts on the Discovery 1 heading towards Jupiter. I guess in the movie, the first movie they were heading towards... in the movie they headed towards Jupiter. But in the novel they headed towards Saturn. But anyway... The setting is you guys are on the ship and the guys just role play. We'll see what happens. What happened in the movie is not going to happen in the game. Something else will happen. It's the same setting, same initialization, same starting sequence. And everyone's role-playing. Someone's role-playing Hal, someone's role-playing Frank, someone's role-playing Dave. Heck, you probably got people role-playing the other crew members that are in hypersleep. You got people role-playing, maybe the GM is role-playing the characters on Earth that are sending messages to the Discovery One. It takes time, it's like maybe 2 hours for a signal to reach the ship. But we're not trying to play 2001 A Space Odyssey. We're not trying to do what happened in the movie. When everyone's in character, interesting things happen because we're role-playing interesting characters. Stuff just happens. Role-play solves everything.
But you get the idea. I'm sorry. I flubbed that one too. I would edit it if I cared enough, but I'm not going to. You know, I want to tell a story like the original Alien movie. Okay, right? I want to tell a story like...
Okay, Alien, I've done that setting so many times. It gets to the point where I'm thinking, was that in the movie or was that in one of my game sessions? It just becomes a blur. That's what happens when the setting matches. Oftentimes, players don't want to play the same characters from the movie. They'll make their own characters. That's fine. we'll call it a reboot. Maybe we don't want to play it in the same year that Alien takes place in. Maybe something near future, closer to Earth. These xenomorphs are on a space station near Mars or something. We change it up. And we determine, is this going to be a cabin fever film? Is it going to be a slow burn? Are we going to be in panic mode all through the game session? Or do we all slowly die off one by one near the end of this session? You know, that kind of stuff. Just to get, you know, what's the mood? What's the themes, the tones, that kind of stuff?
Terminate. I want to tell it. You want to, we are conditioned to want to tell stories like that because we have been told that that.
But we don't have a story. We never have a story. Never, ever, ever. We don't know what the story is even going to be. After the game session, we have an amazing story that we remember. But none of us knew what the story was going to be.
That is the pinnacle of storytelling, kind of, right? That we should be emulating. I think video games have this problem too, in the sense that I think that folks in the video game industry for a long time, their stories were compared to movie stories. They were found wanting. And so the move has been to move closer.
Yeah, game writers are not movie writers. You know what I mean? Name a good screenplay writer. Can they make a good video game? Name a good video game. Can they make a good screenplay? Can they find the person who made the game, can they also do the screenplay and direct the film that's going to be made in a timely fashion? Or are they just going to outsource it? They're going to license it to somebody and they're going to make their own rendition of it? It's going to be a spiritual successor to a video game, or the video game is a spiritual successor to a film. Based on a film, based on a true life film,
closer and closer to movie stories.
Guess what? Spoiler alert: if the story sucks, your whole entire campaign will suck even more because your campaign already sucks because there's no role play. This is why people don't role play, I bet, because it interferes with storytelling.
And a lot of the tech and a lot of the effort has been, how can we make something worthy of a movie? And that's fun. That is a type of story which is fun to tell. It's awesome to tell those. Our games should be able to tell.
When they say tell a story, what they mean is the GM's doing all the talking. The GM's telling all the story. The players are just being polite while waiting to roll dice.
All those types of stories. When we want them to. But I also want to tell a different type of story.
What story comes out of a four-hour-long campaign or a four-hour-long combat session? What story comes out of that? I rolled a crit a few times, and I leveled up twice. So during the slowdown or during the downtime, I can exchange my XP for whatever. That's my story and I'm sticking to it.
I want to tell the story of the party trying to get home after a nasty encounter with a nasty monster and being injured and impaired and whatever, infected. And they have to try to get back. And they're running out of food, and the navigator is, you know, incapacitated, and thus they have to, you know, pick someone who's not suited for that, and maybe they get lost, and
that's fine. But what if the players can't roleplay? Then you have to roleplay for their character. You have to do all the heavy lifting. You have to tell the players what their characters do throughout the entire session, because the players aren't participating. They don't know what to do. Half the time, the players don't even know the rules to the game. They're counting on you to tell them what they need to roll and win. They'll ask, what do I roll? What am I rolling for? But they're really just asking, you know, what number do you need from me? I'll try to roll that number.
Maybe you see where I'm going. I want to also be able, not only do I want to tell the planned cinematic story where I have an outline and I walk you through and you do the things and you
yeah, walking through, that's, he's role-playing all the characters. So he's telling the players, your character goes here and talks to this person and says this to them. And then my character says this back to you. And then you go on to another theme park ride over to this location. So now you're over here now and you're doing this with the city population, blah, blah, blah. You've arrived. The players might say, is there a tavern or is there a blacksmith or and you do the things that normally you would do when you visit a new village and you find all the things that are here and blah 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 and after the day is over you decide to rest at the and the player's saying tavern? Yes. Exactly. You rest at the tavern. And the player's thinking, now do I get to do something? And then the GM says, then you go to sleep and it fades to black. And then you get plenty of rest and it's now morning. And your character gets up and proceeds to do what needs to be done in this village. And as you're doing the things that you need to do for this village, I need you to give me a perception roll. That's when the player thinks, ah, finally, I get to do something. I get to roleplay now. I got to roll dice in this game session. I rolled for perception. That is the state of the hobby right now.
You make one or two choices, but it's, you know, right? The story that I've guided you through, the cinematic narrative story.
Yeah, the perception roles are ways for the GMs to reveal more of a story to the player characters, or to the players, I guess. Player characters are just bookmarks for the most part. So when the players move, it's gone a few pages ahead in the book.
I also want to be able to tell an emergent story, a story that just happens because the way the rules worked. Now, it's a terrible cinematic story because what I really wanted you to do was get to the flame shrine and beat the flame priest, but you didn't get there because in the meantime, I rolled a one.
Okay, Crispy, Rick, Solinar, Nicholas, Mr. Max, Bacon. Who else? Who else? Mickweed. Who else? I know I'm forgetting a bunch of people. Does this blow your mind? If you're even watching this vid, you're probably, you know, you guys have lives. But if you're watching this vid, Flame Zombie, what do you think of this? This guy's actually admitting what he does in his game sessions as far as telling stories to his players. This is crazy. This is insane to me. This guy's actually proud of how he runs games. He's just aching to tell players his story. But, man, the players just didn't do what he was hoping to do, so he has to contrive a plot at the moment to happen. But eventually they're going to get to do the thing he's been aching for them to do in his story.
Wandering encounter with two trolls, and the trolls jumped the party and first round shattered the leg of the guy who's going to do the who's the navigator when they travel, and gravely damaged the healer and so on. And they finally got taken down in a rough battle.
Okay, this has nothing to do with roleplay, so I'm going to skip to the next one. What's number 6? Oh, wow, he goes for a while here. Number 6 is...
Another reason I really like it, frankly, and we'll be short on these two, I think. I'll be longer on this one than the other one, I promise. It allows me to shift gears. So, you know, it's so neat. One of the neat things about RPGs, tabletop RPGs especially, is that there are so many different modes of play. We can be just inner party. The party can be role-playing with itself. Like, I could just be sitting there going, no, I'm good. These guys were talking in character back and forth about, you know, current events or the latest situation or what they're going to do about, or they're not, or they're just talking about the meal they just had, right, in character. That's one mode of play. Another mode of play, obviously, is the back and forth between NPCs and NPCs. Excuse me. Trying to get something done, right? Trying to convince these NPCs. We have a lot of that in our current game because the current game has 7 different groups that have to be able to vote on anything the town does. And so every time something important comes up, you got to at least find out what, and one of the players runs one of the groups. So you have to find out what the other 6 groups are going to vote and figure out what they need to get their vote to you, to your way. And that's another mode of play. And another mode of play is exploration. We're exploring the dungeon or we're exploring the wilderness. You know, and another mode of play could be, and we'll go dungeon exploration and we'll go wilderness travel. That could be a mode of play. And it's different, right? There's different rules to each of them, actually, in most games, in this game particularly. And in a game where there's not a lot of subsystems, and those subsystems are exactly the same, or the game's very rules light, and the GM is just being asked to arbitrate. You know, oh, you're going to travel. Well, okay, which one of you has the pathfinding skill set? Well, I do. Okay, I get +1. Roll 2 dice. Oh, I rolled an 8. That's a 9 because you're +1, and you get there, but you have a complication. Okay, right? And that's fine. I'm not actually dissing anyone's mode of play. I don't care how anyone else plays. But what I like is that when we go from, oh, we're role-playing to, well, we got to make a trip now. Now that's a logistics game, and that shifts gears. We have a subsystem.
Okay, so he's talking about different modes of play. To me, just role-play, stay in character the whole time. Use a game mechanic that works with that. Use a fucking die roll mechanic that works with role-play. Just do that. Okay, what's the next one?
Rules at will. That's what I always tell people. I say, look, you know.
Hey, number 7, I agree. I agree on number 7. If he's going to say what I'm about to say, which is, don't change the rules. Don't add rules. Just don't use all the rules. Just ignore some rules. You know, space combat, right? You can play verbatim using the space combat rules. Or you can just role play through that stuff. The rules are there for space combat because most players can't role play. And they need to know what they're supposed to do when it's their turn. So there's rules for that. If you already have a decent die roll mechanic that determines what characters can do and can't do in any situation, you don't need the fucking space combat rules. And guess what? You can do more stuff in roleplay than you can in using space combat rules where you have to wait while other players are doing their turn. And it's boring as hell. It's long as hell. It's not real time. Anyway, I'm hoping he'll say all this. I'm guessing he's not.
I always laugh when people say cheat, and you know, you have like those 44 rolls, and you go, yeah, some of those guys were cheating, 100%, obviously. I always say, look, there's no reason.
Oh, the 44 guy on Reddit or whatever, that's fake. That's fake news. People have been talking about the 44 rules, whatever. Yeah, it's just a fake post someone put up there. Yeah. Everyone's all serious about it. they took that 44 thing hook, line, and sinker.
Reason to cheat. There's no reason to. First off, I'm rooting for you. Secondly, I can make this game as hard as I want. Like I can, like you know, as you're if you're GMing, I can tune the difficulty however I want. On the fly, if I want to. Now, I tend to try not to. I tend.
Well, difficulty levels need to be consistent. You know, if something was difficult in the past, it should still be difficult relatively. You know, climbing rocks doesn't get easier. We're not leveling up. If it was hard to climb, it's still hard to climb. Maybe you're good at climbing rocks, so it's not as bad for you. But I'll turn the difficulty up a notch. You know, it's starting to rain. The rocks are slippery. You're trying to climb up the rocks. It's dark. You can't see anything. You know, there's the difficulty would still be the same, but now you're rolling with a disadvantage for the most part until it dries out. Gets a bit warmer. The sun is out. You can see what the heck you're doing.
And to try to, you know, set up a scenario and then walk away and stick with it because that's part of the joy. And we can discuss that later. That's a different discussion. But if there's a narrative reason, for instance, that the players, you know, they're done, right? So, or even a mood reason or a table reason. So let's say, you know, okay, they've gone through the dungeon. They are beaten to crap. They have 4 days to get back. The navigator's unconscious. The healer is broken. And we could play that out. And that could take another hour of another rule set that we're sitting there going through. Or I can just hand wave it and go, you're going to make it back. It takes you 6 days and you make it back.
Okay, so he's talking about fast travel then. Yeah, I'll do fast travel sometimes. If nothing interesting is going to happen, we'll just fast travel. You know, if the players want to role play more, if it's interesting for them to role play through that stuff, sure, do it. Do it. You know, I'll come up with something. I'll add something to the mix.
And there could be any number of reasons to do that. One could be, it's late. I want to get them back to town so that we can sort of wrap up, get ideas for their downtime and that they're going to be in town and get ready for the next story or whatever that's coming up. It could be, they're tired of my shit. Like it could really be. They're just tired. It's like, look, we literally spent 3 hours in that hellhole you call a dungeon, and it was rough, and it was awesome, and we had a great time, and we just want a change of pace. So please don't make us roll all the way back. And now they don't say this to me, but you have to read the room as a GM sometimes, and you just go, you know what, I'm going to ignore it and just let them get back, and everybody breathes a sigh of relief, and then we're on to role playing at the tavern or whatever. It's easier to ignore your own rules-heavy bits than to somehow arbitrarily add a subsystem in to be able to shift gears. We're playing a fate, and almost everything we do, you roll the fate dice, and you add and play, and it's based on all your traits and so on, and that's great. But I can't shift gears, so let me add a more detailed combat system. Well, that's actually harder to do on the fly than it is to just ignore what you already got, in my opinion.
Okay, so he's talking about something totally different than me for number 7. Okay. Adding a more complex combat system? Really?
And so for that reason, I tend to lean fairly rules heavy in my games and go, yeah.
Okay, Fate is a third gen RPG. It's a complete waste of time. Some people use it for a campaign, but it seems more of a one-shot, literally a one-shot. You know, Fate is definitely beer and pretzels, one-shot. Pizza and beer, one-shot. In that one, you're just making up 5 traits about your character, and you only get to do those 5 things if you want some sort of a die modifier for your role. So you try to finagle doing the thing, having your character do something that they're designed to do, just so you can get a boost in your die roll. Big fucking whoop.
If I need to ignore a rule, I'm just going to ignore the rule. And if someone comes back and says, hey, why'd you ignore that rule? I'm going to be like, well, because I didn't think you guys wanted to play out the 2 hours of the trip back with everyone injured, you know, or, you know.
Yeah, there's like realistic heavy rules for disease, for infection, for radiation sickness, for drowning, for catching on fire, for explosive decompression, for, there's rules for this stuff. Do you want to go through them all? Do you just want to hand wave that everyone made it fine back to the mothership? Everything's fine. Everything's okay. Or do you want to do the slow grind of losing sanity points as the, you know, the old ones are on board your shuttlecraft, messing with your mind, trying to make you steer towards the sun all the time?
And I try not to ignore rules that benefit the players. That's actually not the point. We're not trying to make the game hard for the players when we ignore these rules. We're typically just...
Okay, so rules that I ignore are usually just ones that... They're too board gamey. If the rules are too board gamey, we just don't use them. You don't need them anyway. If you're in character, what do you need a board game for? If everyone knows where each other are in their mind, they don't need a board. They don't need tokens.
Just trying to do what's correct for the table and the narrative at the time. And you might say, well, if you're just doing what's correct for the narrative, why have the rules in the first place? And the answer is for all the other reasons, frankly. Because...
Why have combat rules? Why have combat rules and then you kind of have this sidebar rules that talk about roleplay for some reason in a war game? There's always a sidebar that says, by the way, in role-playing games, you don't always have to do combat. Sometimes you can just do talkie-talkie. The players can just play patty cake with each other. I hate that. I hate when players talk patty cake with each other. It doesn't move anything. It doesn't progress anything. It doesn't advance anything. Characters, you're not learning anything about the characters when the characters are doing patty cake with each other. But that's how most people roleplay when they try to roleplay. Players will do idle chit-chat with each other. It means nothing. They're just filling time while the GM is coming up with the combat encounter that's going to be forced on them in a linear fashion.
because we got here through the rules, right? We got here through the simulation.
Oh, I was waiting for him to say simulation. I'm glad he said it. These games are not simulators. They're emulators. At best, they only emulate. There's no tabletop RPG that simulates anything. If that were the case, every game session would be real time. And not slow as fuck and boring as fuck. What RPG simulates boredom? Simulates slow action as fuck. What RPG simulates that? Why would these guys say it? It's a great simulator. GURPS is the best simulator ever. It's so amazing. It's so realistic. Okay, so a fight scene that would last maybe 30 seconds goes on for half an hour in GURPS? What is it simulating exactly? Anyway, I gotta go eat.